So it's pawn season, and I know many of you are going to start looking for ideas and how-tos on how to build that dream pawn that you've always wanted to do. However, in my opinion, I believe all great pawns start with inspiration. And in today's video, that's exactly what I'm going to give you.
Behind what we see to be a beautiful pond is the aquarist that created it. Sometimes we get to meet such a great aquarist. So I would like to introduce you to the creator and owner of what I like to call my favorite pond.
Okay, I'm Graham Hawkins. I'm from Halifax, Nova Scotia. I've been keeping fish since I was 7 years old. Started out with a goldfish bowl and a trio of guppies. And that's what, 55 years ago. From there, we went into multiple aquariums, literally dozens of aquariums as a teenager, into saltwater, reef tanks, and the whole gamut of aquariums. And then when we built our home here 30 years ago, a few years later, I put the pond in. About 15 years ago, the pond was modified to become a dedicated koi pond. The pond is approximately 4,500 gallons with another 500 approximately for filtration. The pond is set up like a swimming pool in that it has bottom drains, side returns, skimmers that all feed down into the filtration system.
So we've heard a little bit about Graham. Now, let's take a look at his pond.
Okay, so Graham, this is obviously a beautiful pond, amazing landscaping. Tell me a little bit about the pond. How big is it?
Pond's roughly 15 by 25, averaging about 31, 32 inches in depth.
Okay, so it varies in depth, yeah. As I can see. It looks like it gets deeper as it goes in.
Yeah, it's a little deeper down here towards the waterfall and a little shallower over there. It's bowl-shaped so that you don't get sides caving in. A lot of the ponds in the States, where they're built in sand and that, they have to use cement cinder block walls and reinforce all that. Here, we're in solid clay.
So how long did it take you to get from a basic grass yard to where you are now?
Well, the whole thing started about 26, 27 years ago. Had a few modifications, but initially it only took a few days to put in the basic pond, but at that point it didn't have bottom drains or TPRs, which are the returns over here on the side. Mm-hmm. When the pond was redone 15 years ago, it took probably 2 weeks for all the plumbing, which you'll see in a little while.
I can see that this took a lot of time, potentially a lot of money. However, it's obviously a lot of passion and love for the koi hobby. I've also noticed that these koi are absolutely massive. In fact, they're some of the biggest koi I've ever seen in person. How big are they really?
The largest one is 31 inches. Most of them are around 28 to 30 inches, and a couple slightly smaller than that. Koi can get up on average to 36 inches with a very large girth. As big as these fish are, when you get into the big show quality, the top end fish, they'll be everything you can do to lift them.
Yeah, I can imagine. They're just absolutely huge. So you mentioned you've entered some into competition. Some of them are show quality. And what that says to me is dollar signs. I'm curious, what's the most you've ever spent on a single koi?
On a single koi, $2,000.
$2,000.
And that is the bottom of the show price list.
Wow.
The fish that generally win shows are anywhere from $10,000 to $50,000 each.
Wow. So you've shown me a little bit of the information on the pond. The koi are beautiful. We know more about you. Now I want to see how this works. Do you mind taking us into your filtration room?
Not a problem.
Yeah.
Well, why don't we start here first, just to give you an idea what's going on. Under these covers, there's 2 4-inch drains.
Under these rock covers?
Yes, under the rock covers. And they're fiberglass, by the way.
Oh, nice.
There's do-it-yourself 4-inch bottom drains.
That's awesome.
Just using floor toilet flanges you'd use in your home.
Yep.
That plus a 90-degree pipe, and then a build-up flange on top to sandwich the EPDM. And silicone used as a gasket. Over here, in the pond or koi hobby, they're called TPRs, tangential pond returns.
Okay.
Which gives this whole pond a swirl effect.
Ah, I see that.
And again, instead of using the ones that would normally be in the hobby, these are swimming pool ones.
Okay.
Over here in the corner, there's a skimmer that all feeds back. All the water, the water's returned either via the TPRs or the waterfall.
Now, keep in mind that, Graham, you actually just set this, put the fish in it yesterday.
Yes.
Yeah,
our weather has been so cold.
Absolutely. We had
a long
winter.
Still are cold. The pond's probably only about 55 degrees.
Yeah. So we're not up to 100% set up yet.
Because of the winter we had, it's going to take a good day's work to reset the skimmer. All right, you want to see the filtration system?
Now that we're more familiar with the pond and the koi, it's time to look at the filtration.
Okay, this is where we start to see everything that's buried in underneath the pond is now starting to come out. So you've got 2 4-inch drain lines, a 2-inch line that comes off the skimmer, and then 1.25-inch lines that feed back into the TPRs. From there, this is all gravity fed. From here, the water comes into 2 80-gallon cone-shaped settlement chambers. All the heavy particles, etc., settle out in here. From there, it feeds into 2 barrels that have a mixture of shipping tape and metallic matting, that type of thing, that filter out the finer particles. From there, it comes back into here and filters out even finer particles using metallic and Japanese matting. Bio, all of this will act as bio. I'll bring out K1 and use it in the last one as a static media instead of a fluidized. And that will provide between the algae and all of that, that provides all the mechanical and bio that I need. The water then is sent back. This one returns directly to the waterfall. These two go through 2 40-watt ultraviolet units and go back to the TPRs. Because of the hole in one of them, it's just been re-diverted. One of them has been re-diverted back into the top of the waterfall. There's 2 pumps on the system. The Sequent is pushing about 3,000 gallons an hour, and the Aquaflow is pushing about 4,100 gallons an hour. The cones, each settlement chamber has a bottom drain in them. So once this starts to build up with some heavy sediment, then I can flush it just like you would any other. You want to move over this way, Joey. Just like flushing the toilet. It just drains away. And then it closes. The cone has now been flushed and is filling itself back up to the pond water level. If the power goes out, the water level in all these barrels and cones is exactly the same level as the pond.
So as I mentioned, we are in Canada, and obviously Graham isn't going to keep his koi outside all year round, just because due to the freezing temperatures that we get here. So Graham went ahead and built a designated koi house. Now let's go take a look at that.
This is the koi's winter home here. For years, my fish stayed in the pond and under the ice. And leaving your fish under the ice is a very risky thing to do. It doesn't take much. They barely survive. So it would be easy to lose them. And I did lose them all 1 year, about 15, 16 years ago. The liner was ripped by some ice, the pond drained, losing all the fish. After that, the fish came into the house in some holding tanks. Then they went into my workshop in some bigger holding tanks. and the humidity was, needless to say, doing a job on anything that was around. So at that point, we built a dedicated building just for them. This is the second building. We had a fire about 5 years ago and destroyed the first building. The fish were still in the pond, so it didn't make any difference. But this is the new koi house, and let's have a look. The koi house has two holding tanks in it. One is approximately 2,500 gallons. It's 6 feet deep, 3 feet above ground, 3 feet below. It has a preformed drop-in liner. It also has a bottom drain and side returns. The same basic setup as the pond itself. The smaller tank is about 750 gallons. And again, has bottom drains and two barrels. The plastic barrier that you're seeing here is a jump barrier, just because there's still some fish in here. The one for here has been taken down. The fish generally move back in around the 1st of October. At that point, the water out there has dropped down to around 50 to 55 degrees, and I want to be able to continue to feed them. So both these tanks are heated, and when they come in, their temperature is brought back up to about 75 degrees, and they're heated and fed up until Christmas time, at which time heaters are turned off and the food is turned off also. Koi are basically a four-season fish and should have a cold period. The containers that you're seeing up here are basically a trickle tower, but with a lot more water going through them. They have a combination of kitchen scrubbies and some metallic matting in them, and they act as 100% of the bio. This one acts as 100% of the bio, and on the bigger tank here, there's also a load of K1 media fluidized. This is their filtration, bio and mechanical. In this case, or in both cases actually, a lot of moss has started to grow on the filters. Plants love using high ammonia water, and the plants have done very well, to the point where the last couple of years I have not pulled them apart to move this media out, because it does more advantage in here. To keep it going during the summer, I'll add small amounts of ammonia hydroxide to keep feeding that ammonia supply. Both ponds have, or tanks, also have ear stones that go into them, and that's what you see up here, the Hikato 40 liter per minute. So.
So I got to know, for something like this, there's got to be a lot of maintenance to it. So give me a summary of what are your, you know, your daily or weekly tasks that you do on this pond.
Generally speaking, once the initial spring cleanup has been done and the pond's refilled, the fish are back in, maintenance becomes fairly simple. As I'm showing you down back, once a week, both those cones are flushed, just like flushing a toilet, no different than cleaning the mechanical sump in an aquarium or whatever. After that, there's not a whole lot to do. The best idea is to set it up right first.
Right.
That way you're not fighting with it. You don't want runoff coming into the pond, so liners should be high enough to avoid that. If you don't overstock, then there's no major problem. Other than that, I don't need to do a thing. The water stays crystal clear. That's guaranteed by the UVs. The here algae is generally kept very small because of the fish and because of the huge bios that utilize most of the nutrient.
So now that it's been set up, everything's, you did it right. So ongoing maintenance is pretty much minimal, other than when seasons change and you need to move the koi around.
Yep.
Yeah. What would you estimate the ongoing costs for something like this? Say, throughout the summer, when the pond is in full effect, what would you say a monthly bill for food and maintenance costs?
Electricity is obviously the biggest thing, the biggest expense. On average, my ponds run about $150 a month on the power bill. Because you've got so many water pumps running. There's two down here, there's two in here, plus the ultraviolet units.
So what about food? How much food do you feed these guys?
they'll eat about 50 pounds of food in the summer.
Wow.
And you're talking $250 a bag, plus shipping to get it here. Because you do not buy out of the local pet store one of these little cans of food. They would eat it in a day and a half.
A day, yeah.
So when I bring it in, I bring in 500-600 pounds, and that lasts me, you know, for a couple of years.
All right, well, so I think that's a good note to end this video on the topic of food. We've become food for all of these black flies flying around our head. Graham, I want to thank you for letting us come into your yard and spending some time with us and showing us your beautiful pond. I hope that a lot of you guys enjoyed it at home. And if you guys want to see more things like this, and if you'd like to see me possibly revisit Graham's pond, or maybe I talk to him about other topics, just let me know in the comments section below. He's definitely an amazing aquarist with a lot of knowledge and information that he can share and help you with. Graham, again, thanks for having us.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.